Hi, this is Marcus. I am actually broadcasting live on 4 social media platforms at one time. I'm actually live on YouTube, LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter all at the same time. So I'm going to go ahead and take care of this. Let me just click back on this and let's just see what we're doing here. I got something on the screen. Okay. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and edit this photo here live online. And I'm just going to go ahead and get started. And I don't want to take up too much time. And I'm also want to test out to see how well this service is working to allow me to broadcast in 4 different platforms all at one time. So I'm trying to keep an eye on anything that may come in as a comment. So let me just make sure that I can see those things. So if someone does say something or if a comment come in, then I'll be able to see that, because right now I can't see anything. Now I can. So if a comment comes in, I will try to address it. So with that stated, I'm shooting here. These photos were taken with the GFX Fujifilm 50S Mark II. And it makes me edit a little bit different than I would if I was using a full frame or if I'm using a crop sensor. Right now, I use all Fujifilm cameras. I have the X-T5, the X100V, and I have the GFX 50R and the GFX 50S Mark II. And the reason for that is because there's a lot of detail, there's a lot of color depth and dynamic range in this photo. So in my personal studio, my studio that I have for photography is a 400 square foot, so it's not really small, but it's not big either. It falls in between of being a medium-sized studio, and so a lot of times what I would do is I'll shoot in both JPEG and RAW, and the JPEG will just be to give me that perspective when I'm tethering, because I'll shoot in 1:1. Now, there's a reason why I shoot in 1:1. And now the RAW file doesn't represent that. If I'm using Lightroom, Lightroom would have recognized I did 1:1 and it would have put it on the RAW file, not actually writing it to it, but it would have automatically assigned that crop to it. I can do that here in Capture One just by processing the photos and actually having a preset for the 1:1, but I like to just do it manually. And the reason I shoot 1:1 when I'm in the studio or shoot at a square is because I don't have to rotate the camera in the portrait mode. If you're shooting in square, everything is the same size on either portrait or horizontal or even in landscape. So that way you don't have to rotate your camera or anything. And so let me just go ahead and get this set correctly. Another thing I wish the Fuji would actually do is actually go ahead and select the film simulation that we're using. Right now it's doing auto. And what I used was nostalgic negative. So I know that I'm using that. But if for some reason you don't know that, a lot of times you'll have to go in here and actually find the film simulation you're using. Now, the good thing about it is that you can switch. If I shot a nostalgia negative and didn't like it, I could actually switch into something else, right? But we're going to go and stay with nostalgia negative. And I'm going to go ahead and correct all of the lens deficiencies that are here. I use the 45 to 100 millimeter at f/5.6. And so we're going to go ahead and do that. There is going to be some vignetting and you'll see that come off, and there shouldn't be any defringing, but we're going to take care of that. And then I like to go into here, even though there's no chromatic aberration, I like to go here and tell it to analyze the file, so it'll just give me one directly here for that file there. And then also what I'm going to do is, now I can do some keystoning too, because I shot in an angle. I used to keystone it to get it, you know, correctly and flat, then I just start letting it stay at that angle. What I'm gonna do right now is just rotate it to make sure that it is correct, and it is correct. So it didn't move at all. It stayed at zero even when I hit this right here. Oh, there it is. So now we're gonna go ahead and crop, and I'm gonna crop into 1:1. So we're gonna all square. We're gonna hit this crop here, and that's what I'm going to crop at right there. And so that will give me, this is how it looked when I tethered. And so I'll go ahead and hit that, and that's what we're cropping in. So the camera is a 51 megapixel when you're shooting at a crop ratio of 4.3. If I shoot in the crop ratio of 1:1 or square, it drops it from 51 megapixels down to 38 megapixels is what you get with that. So now we're going to go ahead and I'm going to go in here and there are presets and stuff that I have, but I very rarely use any presets. I like to do my own thing here. So if we go into the photo, a lot of things were done correctly. There are some things I'm going to have to do. I'm going to have to take care of the toenails on the model. But the majority of everything else, this is straight out of camera, no editing. So everything is pretty much good, but I want to do a few things. And now, you know, we have these digital cameras and we spend a lot of our time trying to mimic film look. And right now, the way this actually came out, if I go ahead and hit what was actually max with this, you can see all of this right here. Everything in green is what they say that is the sharpest, but the photo is sharp. I was using the eye detection for the camera. And a lot of times what I'll do is I'll use manual focusing. Manual focusing in the studio is a lot quicker and more accurate than you would get with autofocusing. And let me explain real quickly here. When you autofocus, the camera has to obtain focus again. And a lot of times it'll tell you that it's in focus, but you'll take the picture and it's not. And so you'll have a hit rate of maybe, if the subject's not moving that much, you'll probably be in the 90 percentile of it and actually acquiring it and the focus is correct. But there's that other 10% where it's not. Well, if I manual focus and I'm using focus peaking and I'm looking at the back of the camera, as long as she's not making too big of a drastic move, she will always be in focus and I can always, and in that way I can click as long as the strobe can keep up with what I'm actually shooting. So a lot of times I would shoot manual focus. This time I just didn't do that. I wanted to test out their eye detection. It worked pretty good, but this is a sharp photo. And I don't want to over sharpen it because it will kind of, you know, there is some film that is actually really, really sharp. But for the most part, film is not as sharp as what you would get with digital. And so I want to kind of give that filmic quality in there. So we're going to go back into this. And so if I look at this, really, there's nothing I need to do with this other than to take it into Photoshop. And I could actually just, you know, release it because it looks really good. The skin on the model is really good. There's not a whole lot of things I need to do. There is some, you know, you can see the light hitting the background here. Some of that I can take care of, and I'm going to do that. But so let me just go ahead and go to the highlights. I'm going to pull the highlights down like this, and you'll see more of that wall start to come in, right? And I'm going to pull some white down, and you'll see more of that wall just coming in back here. So let's go before and after. You'll see this is what we had before. This is what we got now, and I don't know why we got that because I shot a nostalgic negative, but it's showing that I actually chose something else. This was nostalgic negative, so that's what we actually got. We'll take that off, and so we'll go back into the contrast. Now, some people like to actually pull contrast up. I like to do that kind of after everything else is done because contrast, what it does is it amplifies the blacks and the whites, and it'll do it at the detriment of the midtones. So I like to take the contrast in reverse, which will lighten up the photo. And then I'll go into, well, I've already did that. This is what I did right now. So by me pulling the whites down, I can actually leave this like this, because what I would normally do is just pull the contrast back, right? Pull that back. It kind of lightens everything up. And then I'll pull the black back, which will amplify that black area. And then I'll pull the white up, but in the area to where they may not be equal. When you do it in contrast, it tries to equally disperse and amplify each of the spectrums. You know, it tries to do it evenly. So that's what I'm going to go with there. And then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pull some of the, because I want to play with the shadows. I'm going to pull some of the exposure down about a quarter of a stop. And then I'm going to go to the levels here. And the levels here, 255 is your true white, 0 is your true black. But I can repoint that to a different area. So I can say, you know what, instead of this being my true white, I want this area here to be my true white. And you can see that photo comes in a little bit contrasty now, right? And if I look at the histogram, you'll see that that moves. So if I push this back like it was, you'll see there's, you know, basically nothing in the highlight area. Everything is pretty dull. But if I go ahead and drag that to here, now I've put some information in there. And what I'll actually do with this here is I'll use a little bit of the dehaze to amplify the some of the contrast as well. Pull it to about 10. I'm going to use clarity, which is going to pump up the midtones, right? And I'm going to take structure in reverse. Now I could play around with the hair and do a few things here. I still want to bring this down, but I'm going to do that on a separate layer using a gradient. So first I'm going to go into here and I'm going to take care of the areas over here by pulling in some vignetting. I just took it out using the lens parameters, but I'm going to put a little bit of it in. So now I just got just this area in here to kind of pull that back if I want to, and I'll take care of that. So, I could actually do like, so let's do that right now. Since I've been talking about it, let's go ahead and I'm going to create a new layer, a new fill layer. And then I'm going to go ahead and take this right here and drop it to here. That's the area that I want to bring down. And I'm going to bring this down like this, right? Just a little bit. And so when I do that, now what I'm going to do is I can do it in a couple ways. I'm going to see how the radio does this. Now, when I do this, you'll see that it's going to lighten it up. No problem. What I'm going to do is just invert this layer, and it's the other way, right? So we're going to do it this way. And then I have the privilege of bringing down the opacity. So we'll do it like this. I'll bring the opacity to zero, and then I'll just bring that up to a desired look of how I want to get that back as much as I can without really doing too much to it. There we go. I think that looks much better. We don't have that bright spot that's actually hitting it, and bring that up to there. So we got this. And then I can actually go into that layer as well, and I can warm that up just a little bit more warmer so it'll blend in a little bit better with the rest of the photo. So you can see what we got there. So again, this is before what we had, before everything's done. And then we just did this before that's done. So we got that. We'll go back to the background layer, right? And in the background layer, what I'm going to do with this is I am going to basically go into the exposure and I'm going to pump up the brightness. So in the brightness, I'm going to push that up right there, and that'll help a little bit of the midtones come up a little bit brighter, about right there. I still want to keep this shadow area. If I look at this right here, I can still see the details of the hair. Now, if it's important to bring that hair up, I can go here inside of Capture One, go to my built-in style brushes, go to light and contrast, and go into shadow recovery. Hit the M so I can see this. And as I do this, this will show me exactly what I'm bringing up. If it's important to bring that up, right? If I want to see more of it. Without me having to bring up anything else. And if I take that off, you'll see there's going to be too light, and that's fine. Let's go closer so we can see it. So what I can do again, I have the ability to just take that opacity down and just bring it up to the level of where I want this to be, or I can see more of the curls of the hair without affecting anything else in there. So we got that. That looks pretty good. So we have that. And so now we're going to go back down to the background layer. And in the background layer, we got everything that I needed to have. The photo is good. Now we're going to play around with some color, which I love the colors that we have. But what I want to do right now is I'm going to go into the actual color wheel here. And we're going to be on the background layer. Now, a lot of people will put this on a separate layer itself because they want to have the option of lowering the opacity for it when you're using this. You know what? I'm going to go ahead and do that because that's what a lot of people would like to do. So let's go ahead and create another layer. And I'm going to call this color grading. Color grading. And this other one here was to actually darken a hot spot. So let me just say hot spot. Okay, so the layers have been, so we go back to this color, a gray layer. And what I want to do is kind of grit some harmony. Now, normally what I would do in my shadows is I would cool my shadows off. And if I pull this to the blue area and pull it off, it gives a different color to it, right? I could do that and cool the shadows off, but I want to do something a little bit different. I want to warm the shadows up, actually, but not by that much. Let's warm it up. And then in the highlights, I'm going to go in the total opposite direction and kind of cool off the highlights, which is going to make the white pop out because the white is going to be on that blue spectrum. So it's going to make that come out a little bit more. And then in the mid-tones, I'm going to take that toward the turquoise end of this right here, right? And then, so now I got this look that's not as punchy and the skin tones look good. And I'm going to go into the master of this and pull it over to where here. Pull it towards the orange. Pull it a little bit more. There we go. And so that's the look that I would like to have for this. I'm going to settle on this. And again, if we go before and after, right? Let's just go before. This is what we had before. This is what we came out with. Had this before. We came out with this. So that actually works really well. So now what I'm going to do with this is we're going to take this into Photoshop. We're going to right click, go into Photoshop with this. And there's a couple things that I'm going to use. Now, I've been using Photoshop since the early 90s. When I started doing what we call photo manipulation, I was using a program called Micrograph Picture Publisher, which was rated much higher than Photoshop back in the 90s. And I was an official beta tester for Corel Corporation, which I was using Corel Photo Paint and a few other applications. So I've been doing it for a while. And what I've done is I've invested in a lot of AI tools that just makes my workflow go by a little bit quicker. You don't have to have these things to do what I'm doing. You can do them individually, but my workflow is something like I can knock out 20 photos in less than an hour and a half and have them all have the same look and color feel versus doing each one individually. And so what I'm going to do with this right now is now, normally I would take time and do this a whole lot better, but I'm going to do it quickly because it's just a little small part of this. Let's go ahead and hit Control J to copy that. I'm going to hit B for my brush. And this is just going to be very quick. This is not going to be anything a little bit scientific. We just want to paint that in a little bit. Now I could go in and make it a whole lot better, but this is just what we want to do with that. That's going to work out fine. And I'm going to go do the same thing. Just click this here. And I'm just, because it's such a small region, right? It's such a small region that I'm actually preparing. Then I'm going to go ahead and do this. Take this right here and just, there's a little bezel that's there. We'll just smooth that out like that and smooth this out right here. And we're good to go. So there's nothing else really I need to do with that. That's taken care of. So we got that done. And so now we're going to use these AI tools. Now the AI tools I'm using is Retouch for Me. You can run these individually outside of the panel. They run for about $129, $149. So if you bought all 10, you'll be out of a lot of money, about $1,000. And if you are into doing your own photos and you really want to customize and get your workflow going, I would very much say pick out one of the tools that you would like to use and go ahead and purchase it because it's doing a phenomenal thing using the AI or the neural engines is what it's actually using. The only one I don't have is skin mask because Capture One and Lightroom both have a very good masking for skin. So I didn't get that one, but I have the rest of them. And so I'm going to choose portrait. I'm going to choose brilliance of eyes. She don't have any vessels or anything in the eyes. Well, let me make sure, because if she does, I need to make sure I go in and look at that. I don't think she has any redness in the eye. She doesn't. So there's no reason to choose that one. And I could go into the menu and I can choose these individually, right? And I can set parameters and I can do a whole bunch of things, but I'm gonna show you how this actually works. It's gonna stick this on a separate layer and then I can go ahead and edit the layers if I want to. If she had a lot of wrinkles in her garment, I would use fabric. If I was on some paper, I would use clean up the background. None of that's needed. She's not smiling, so I have to do white teeth. So we're just gonna use these five here. Heal, dodge and burn, skin tone, which is gonna find any variations in the skin. Portrait volume is basically doing contouring of doing dodging and burning to give some depth to the photo or to make it 3D dimensional. And then we have the eye brilliance here. So I'm going to go ahead and run these. And again, I'm broadcasting live on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and YouTube at the same time. So I hoping everything is going right, and I'm hoping that everyone is able to see this, what's actually going on here. So what it's doing right now is it's actually go ahead and running the process. So even though I'm broadcasting live and I'm running this, I have a very good workstation for my photos. I'm using the Mac Studio. I'm using Mac Studio M1 Max chip with 64 gigabyte of RAM. And I got some very good external hard drives, which are all SSD and Thunderbolt 3. So they're actually moving pretty well. And the machine has really performed beyond what I thought it would do. So now we got this done. So let me just go ahead and throw these all in the same group by highlighting them and hitting Control G. And I just want to let you see what it's actually doing to this. And this is why I use this tool, because it does such a good thing. Now, I have a tool that does just skinned. And let me show you this tool. So what I'm going to do is turn this off right here. Right. And I'm going to use this tool just to show you this. When I go in here, there's one by Imaginomics called Portraiture 4, and it does nothing but skin, and it does a phenomenal job on it. It's $199 just for skin. That's all it does is skin, and it does a phenomenal job, right? So you're going to see what this does. I'm just going to let you see what it does real quickly here. I'm not going to use this. And so what happens is it normally comes in with everything perfect for the skin. I don't like things to be perfect, so I'll click this and drop it to about 65, if not go lower. And I would probably even go lower. So you can see what it did to the skin. It does very well. I'm going to go ahead and take this one off, because that's the layer that is on, and hit this one. But you can see those AI tools with the sculpturing of using volume actually did a very good job too. So I've been using these tools, and I've been using the other one much less. So if I go ahead and turn this one on, if I take that off, you can see the skin on here is very good. But I'd have to go in and do what we would call I would have to go in and do contouring, right, to really bring out the three-dimensional of certain parts of the face. But with this tool here and the dodging and burning and the thing that fixes, that heals all the blemishes, when I go in here, this looks good. So let me just go ahead and delete that. I just want to show you that, just how well this application works. So we're going to go ahead and expand this. And so now what I'm going to do is take a look at everything else. Now, in my opinion, her eyes are too brilliant. So if I turn that off, you can see how the eyes look. I turn it back on, it looks okay, but I'm gonna drop this to 65% opacity. And then we're gonna look at, so the heel is what removes all of the blemishes. So let me just turn this off individually so you can take a look at this. Let me get a little bit closer so you can see what's actually going on here. So we're gonna bring it here. And I'm gonna turn off all of these things here. So let's just turn them off, and I'm gonna turn them back on, and you'll see. So you can see there's little blemishes on the skin. When I turn on heal, heal will take care of the blemishes, right? And if I go dodge and burn, all of the little dark spots that you see here, that's going to take care of that. You see around the eyes how I took all those dark spots out. And then for skin tone, it's going to fix any different variations of the skin. That's been fixed. So we turn that on. And then we go into volume. And what volume does is you can see the depth that it adds, right? Now, sometimes it goes a little bit too much, and it is going too much in an eye brilliance. I'm going to go down here to the volume, and I'm just going to put it on about 55%. And if I just take that off and put it back, I think that's enough to have it on 55%. And so the photo still looks pretty good. So I like what we have here. And really, I could just stop here, but I'm going to do a little bit more to it. And it's probably a little bit unnecessary. Now, the contrast of this looks very good. There's no reason to do any more contrast. And I'm going to do a couple things. I'm going to use a tool to do sharpening by Topaz, which I find to be the best sharpening tool on the market. And I have them all. I have all the plugins for sharpening tools. And the ones in Capture One and Lightroom does a good job, too. But this tool is something special. So let me just go ahead and hit Command J. And we're going to go into this right quick. And I'm going to go under Topaz and go to Sharpen AI. And it is a phenomenal tool. Now, what it will allow me to do too is I can mask certain areas. It's got different modes. And so what it does is it goes and you can take a look at it. And I'm paying attention to the skin tone and everything else. I actually like what this has done right here. This has done a very good job. Now, you can hit auto, and auto will go in and make it too sharp for my taste. You see, now I can see more sharpness in here, but this is more like that digital sharp. And I don't want it to be that sharp at all. Now, I could actually go ahead and apply it and then lower the opacity on it. But there's no reason to do that. I'm going to take the automatic off. And I'm going to hit standard and see what it does with standard. Standard is the one I normally go with. That gives me enough sharpening. I think that gives me enough sharpening. But let's go with this one right here where it just says out of focus. Let's see what this one gives me. I like that one. Let's go right here. I'm looking at what it's doing to our hair. That brought out more of the hair. It's not really hurting the skin or anything. We're going to go with this one. Now, being that she's kind of on the same plane, I could really apply the sharpness to the entire photo. So if you look over here, you'll see over here where there's a little blurriness in this area where it's giving some separation. But in here, that's actually bringing everything out. I want it to stay that way. So I'm going to go ahead and hit select. And that's going to go ahead and do a selection of hair. And thank you. Thank you a lot. TMDD. Thank you so much. And then we're going to go in here and we're going to reframe. And you can see the areas that it's actually selecting. So it selected certain areas, but it didn't get her foot. And so what I'm going to do is we're going to add this, and I'm going to just bring in her feet in here. I want that to be sharpened, right? And you know what? I could take the couch out, you know, the parts of the couch, but it's on the same plane. I'm going to go ahead and let it do its thing. I want to just leave it like that, but I could take that couch off. And really, I should put the entire couch in this. Okay, yeah, I see it now. Yeah, thank you so much. TMIDD, I think that's what it's showing on the screen. The screen is small. Forgive me if I mispronounce it, but thank you so much. I'm going to go ahead and add the rest of this all in this plane as well. All right, now let me just increase the size of this so I can get done with this very quickly. I want all of this couch to be in there, right? So we're going to go in here, and we're just going to do this very quickly here. And I'm going to move this over so we can get all of this in here. Because it's on the same plane with her, right? So we're just going to go here, and I'm going to go back here a little bit and get some of this here. I don't have to be as perfect as I want to be, but I think that works there, right? And so I'll say update, and now it updates, and now I got that change in there. So if I go down to her feet, you can see they're more sharper as well. That works for what I want to do. Let's go ahead and hit apply. And then apply is going to push this back. Back down to the photo. Okay, so now we just got that applied, and now you can go into 100% here, and you can see the sharpness didn't affect the skin. Photo looks really, really good. And so everything looks very good on the photo. So the next thing I wanna do with this, is, again, I have a lot of plugins that make my life a lot simpler. I can do all these things manually, but why do it? And the reason I'm flattening this file and saving it, because if I happen to crash, I don't want to have to redo this, right? So I should have explained that before. Now I'm going to go into a plugin that's called, this has very good contrast, but we're going to make the contrast a little bit better. We're going to go into Nick Collections, and we're going to go into Color Effects 5. And I have templates that I've taken the time to create. Like, for instance, everything that you see as a custom template here within the things that you see is something that I've taken the time and created. Like, if I wanted to change this whole look and feel here inside Color Effects, I could click this and that would be the look of it. It took me about maybe 30 to 40 minutes to do a lot of these presets based on how I work. And they always give me a consistent result. I could go with the fine art. Now, this is one I normally use when I have a more darker background when I'm trying to get fine art or a fall day for outside. But I just want to add standard contrast. Now, what it's doing is removing the color cast that I don't want it to remove. So I'm going to pull that back. I don't want it to do anything with color casting at all. I want this to, you know, to really do what it's doing. So the white is popping out a little bit more because it's being amplified. And to not have to take down the opacity when I get it back into Photoshop, I'm going to drop the opacity here. So it'll stay. I got it at 45. Let's keep it at 52. I'll go ahead and hit apply. And then that will actually come in and write itself to it. That's what it's doing now. And you'll see that it's there. And so that's been done. So the photo is really good. All it did was give me a little bit more contrast. You can see that the white garment is really popping out and the blacks are looking pretty good. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go into a tool called Analog Effects Pro. Now, I've used Dehancer Pro, which they just came out with a major update that changed a lot of the parameters. So I'll be doing a new video on the new version of Dehancer, because they added a couple new things that makes it a little bit better. But there's another application by Nik Collection called Analog Effects Pro. And what it allows you to do is create these analog or these antique type of cameras. So what you actually go in here and do is, there are presets that you can use, but I'm in a thing that's called, so all of these presets in custom are things that I've created, right? Over the years, some of these are named after models. So when I shoot a model, I go back and use that preset. So I have this consistent look for the model when I work with them again, because I like working with models that I've worked with before, because our shoots just get better because we have a level of trust and the familiarity with each other, and everything seems to work better. But I'm going to go into Camera Kit. And in Camera Kit here, you can build custom cameras. There's things like to add distortion if you needed to do that. You can add bokeh. You can add zoom and a whole bunch of other things that you can do. Now, we're not going to do any of these things that I just added. Now, let me just remove them out of here. But this is what we're going to do. So let me take that off. Come on. Okay. Let me remove it from here. It don't want to remove. Here we go. That's because I took out the basic. So something has to stay in there. So by me removing basic, it makes you keep something in there. Let's take zoom out. So you have to have at least one of these in there. And so basic is the one that stays in there. So what I want to do with this right now. Now, they have a very good extraction tool. And I can actually go in here and drop a control point to extract out. So I want to extract a little bit more of this out right here back there with the floral back here. So we're going to click this. And I'm going to hit this area to see just what it's masking on, right? So that's masking pretty good on the subject I want it. And so let's bring back this, because it'll actually give you a default parameter that I do not like. And so we're going to go ahead and go into the luminous and just narrow it down to that selection. I don't want it to spill over to other things, right? So I got some spillover back on this wood here. So we're going to narrow that down so we get less spillover and put this here. And I'm going to hold down the Alt key and drag and get another one right there. Then we're going to go ahead and select both control points, hold them down, and hit this to group it. So when I make one change to one, it does it all. And so when I go into here, now when I extract this, you're going to see that floral a little bit better. That's going to come in a little bit better when I go into that 100% and go back to that area. You can see that's coming in. And I have the ability to saturate it, right? So we can saturate it a little bit better. And we got that. So that's basically what I want to do. I don't want to try to bring out the extraction of it because it's already soft back there. So we want to just keep that at zero, but I just want to bring out some saturation in it. And I can lighten it up. See that? Just that area there. And that's all I want to do with that. All right. So I just want to bring that out with color. The next thing we're going to do is go and grab a film type. And on this film type, what it does is allow you, they got different warm film types. So they got 9 warm film types. We have 9 cool film types. And for subtle, we have a total of 12. And then we got the black and white. These are film types that you can use. Now, this is a warmer type of film. So this is what I want to use. So I think I'm going to stay with the first one, which is the Acon 1 or the Acon 1. But I'm just going to click through the other ones and see which one gives me the best look. This gives me the warmest look if I wanted to have that. That's more on that warm look that I would actually have. And this right here. We're going to go with the first one that keeps it true to what it is. And then we have a strength of, if I zero that down, then it doesn't bring any of that film tone to that. And but I'm going to drag the fade, which is going to kind of give it a faded look to give me that analog look. And then I'm going to go into strength and I'm going to bring it in. So it'll bring some of it in. I'll bring it in about 30%. Then I'm going to add some grain. So I'm going to make the grain harsh at about maybe 40%. And I'm going to drop the grain per pixel down to like 469. And if I go on to one, I don't want it to be too grainy, but I want it to have that little organic grain in there, which makes the photo look really, really good. And so that's basically what I want to do with that, right? So there's nothing else for me to add on to this. Now, I could add on dirt and scratches to kind of make it look vintage. The thing I would like to do is sometimes I want to add a frame to it. So I can go to this frame, and one of the things I like with this frame is if I go to white, I can add on. If you've ever seen film developed and how they get the frames and get the borders, this does a very good job to it. And I want to give it, you know, being I'm shooting a medium format camera, I want to give them medium format kind of borders and things that you would normally see from the older type of thing. So we can go into them. I'm just looking at the ones that I'm, you know, taking more of a look at that would actually look pretty good. And I'm going to go with, I'm looking at, that's good, but I want something a little bit more dramatic. Like this one is one that I may go with that black. It's between that one. Let's see what this one looks like again. That's okay. Let's see. This one's going to put a 264 here. That looks really kind of vintage as well, but I'm looking at what we got here. I think this one in the middle is going to give me what I want. And I think this one here. See. I like... Let me go back to this one right quick. There was one I like a little bit more. No, there's another one that I'm missing. I'm missing one. That's something that gives me, let me look at this very quickly. I don't want to take a lot of time on this because I have a certain, that's that one. Let's go back here. It's one that had a little bit more white in it that I liked. And let's see, but this one, yeah, we're going to go back to this one. This was the one I'm going to choose. For the border, we're going to go ahead and hit apply. It's going to write that back to it. And it's loading it up. And it's almost done. Processing time. And there we go. So that's there. And now I'm just going to go ahead and flatten this. This photo is done. We're going to go ahead and hit quit. Save it. It'll take it back. And this is the photo we sent over. Let's go into 100% here. Looks okay. This is the photo we brought back as a square. So when I edit medium format photos taken with the medium format camera, I do everything in a little bit of moderation because it's more, let me see something right quick. I'm going back to this. This is something that added to this, and I'm gonna leave it there. But I try to add edit in moderation because it's got so much color depth and so much details that if you don't do it in moderation, you could go just too far too quickly. And so, but that's the photo. We're going in, it's 100%. You can see everything looks pretty good. This is more colorful. Go down to the feet. We can go back to everything else. You can see the details. Everything looks really, really good. And so I have a podcast that I'm getting ready to finish up for the third episode on the Fujifilm GFX cameras systems. I have two of them. And so I'm really into the medium format camera system. And so for those of you that are interested in Fuji, I will have a link to that podcast for you to listen to it if you want to. And if you haven't subscribed to any of the four platforms that I'm broadcasting live on, please subscribe, and I'm going to bring you more of these things to go. Thanks for watching. Thanks for all your comments. And if you have any questions, send me an email. Thank you again.